those years of wisdom and compassion. We've been so, so lucky.
Her work ethic, her strong faith, her leadership. There wasn't anything Her Majesty couldn't do.
There was a courtesy and a humanity and a kindness that I'll remember forever.
It was a life of public service and duty. Committed her country.
My lords and members of the House of Commons, I pray that the blessing of Almighty God may rest upon your councils.
And her Commonwealth.
I feel enormously proud of what the Commonwealth has achieved, and all of it within my lifetime.
Devoted wife and mother. A constant figure of national pride. As the world around her witnessed extraordinary change. Born in 1926, Princess Elizabeth wasn't expected to be queen. Home videos show it was a happy childhood.
In those days, it was such wonderfully unorganised fun. We played a game called Catching Happy Days, which involved roaring around the garden at great speed, catching the leaves as they fell off the trees. That kept us happy all day.
Her destiny changed with the death of her grandfather and the abdication of her uncle. Her father was now king and Elizabeth his heir. Her role for life was set and her approach to it shaped by the Second World War, clear even in her first broadcast when she was evacuated to Windsor.
My sister, Margaret Rose, and I feel so much for you, as we know from experience what it means to be away from those we love most of all.
The keep calm, carry on philosophy was absolutely embedded in her, I think.
The princess became a member of the ATS.
She joined the Auxiliary Territorial Service as others went off to fight.
Lieutenant Mountbatten seems glad to be back at work again.
Wartime also sparked the most important relationship of her life. She kept in touch with Prince Philip by writing letters. And in 1947, they got engaged. A glamorous young couple, their wedding was celebrated across the country. Soon, Prince Charles was born, followed by Princess Anne.
They're taking the places of the King and Queen who would have gone but for His Majesty's illness.
But duty called, her father was ill, and they had to take his place on a tour of the Commonwealth.
To the stunned heart of London, and to the whole Commonwealth, came the tragic news from Sandringham of the passing of a beloved sovereign, King George VI.
In a remote lodge in Kenya, Prince Philip told her the news. She was now queen.
All accounts say that she gulped, gathered herself, a grieving daughter, but also now the queen, in a way that she could never have imagined, and of course in her early 20s at the time.
The following year came her coronation, broadcast for the first time on television.
She was very conscious of the fact that she needed to be out there, to be visible, going right back to televising the coronation.
Only 26, Queen Elizabeth still had to prove herself to courtiers, politicians, and the country. Years later, she described how it felt.
In a way, I didn't have an apprenticeship. My father died much too young. It was all a very sudden kind of taking on. And making the best job you can.
From the very start, she felt she had to get out and connect with the public.
The Queen and Duke now took their places.
Through thousands of engagements and inventing the walkabout.
Whether you were the lollipop lady or you know, you were a president or a prime minister of a nation, people become nervous. And it was wonderful to see how Her Majesty would put them at ease.
Always calm, even when blanks were fired at Trooping the Colour, the Queen was constantly on duty, with constitutional responsibilities and weekly audiences with her prime ministers.
For someone who just, who'd been a little boy in the streets of Durham waving a flag when she drove through in the 1960s, and suddenly there you were, you were prime minister, virtually alone, of all the people that you knew anything that you said to her stayed within the room.
Always displaying her support for the military.
The principle of listening to what she thought Churchill might have done in similar conditions or circumstances to what I found myself in. It was those sort of conversations that I learnt a huge amount from and will treasure forever.
It's really nice comments, including one from President Biden.
Oh, that's very kind.
As every day, there were red boxes full of state papers to deal with.
Do we think that this is a good idea? Do we not know what it's about?
She was a wonderful boss. We used to put up a red box every evening, and we knew that she would have been through them and it would be back on our desk the next morning at 8 o'clock. It was extraordinary how she did this day after day throughout her reign.
It wasn't just matters at home. As head of the Commonwealth and queen of other realms, she travelled more than any other head of state.
I remember going to Uganda for the Commonwealth Heads of Government Conference, and from the airport to the hotel, I don't think I've ever seen crowds like it.
Always conducting her own powerful form of soft diplomacy.
I did get a sense how concerned she was sometimes about some of the conflicts, some of the challenges. She can have a personal conversation which, you know, helps to move on some really quite difficult and tricky political moments.
I think we haven't yet been waiting. Very nice to see you.
They melt around her, and I've seen the strongest men just literally sort of become putty in her fingers. They are all in awe of her.
Uchtiroin Argus Akoiza.
The first British monarch to visit the Republic of Ireland in 100 years. She was a figurehead of unity and stability.
She never wavered from duty or service. And in uncertain times, people need anchors. We've lost one of our most important anchors.
I'm very glad to have been able to join you today.
There at times of national tragedy, including the coronavirus pandemic, adapting the way she worked to reach out, set an example, and rally the nation with messages of resilience.
We should take comfort that while we may have more still to endure, better days will return. We will be with our friends again. We will be with our families again. We will meet again.
Her Majesty is the warrior queen. She has done it. She's been there. When Her Majesty dressed the nation, it's the empathy. We're all in this together, but it's going to be okay.
My grandfather broadcast the first of these Christmas messages.
Her Christmas broadcast every year was her chance to send a personal message.
It's no surprise that families so often treasure their Christmas routines.
Because behind the formality was an utterly devoted wife and mother.
Prince Andrew, 5 last February, probably feels quite senior now that he has a baby brother.
The family is very close together and we do enjoy spending time. And she's always made time all the way through her life. And yes, there have been those particular moments of the year when that very much comes first.
When we were very young, obviously, it was harder for her to have so much time. And we were obviously living elsewhere as well, so we were never really all together in the same place. But whenever we had the family moments and we met up, she'd be very keen on watching what the children were up to. And I think there were moments when she loved the noise and running around the house. It kind of brought the house to life and it kind of made the real family atmosphere.
I think they'd be strong enough.
Can I go on up there?
We see if this is strong enough to...
Get off. I want it.
While she was head of state, Philip was head of the family and a huge support.
Come around this side.
Nasty feeling, isn't there? Another brother.
They were a couple with a different relationship than many people have. But he learnt to live with that. It's difficult to be a monarch with the degree of responsibility that you have without a very good partnership to back you up.
Yes. When there were tough moments, if he was around, it was hugely important. You could see them working a crowd or working a walkabout.
You watch it, they'll stuff you.
It wasn't planned, it was instinct. They both had the same metabolic clock, I think.
In 2021, she said goodbye to her beloved husband and dedicated consort.
We have been inspired by his unwavering loyalty to our Queen.
What you see is courage, but also a complete lack of self-pity. She feels grief, but as she said on one occasion, it's not about me.
In a less deferential world, they did weather more difficult times, especially in the 1990s, as her children got divorced and a fire wrecked Windsor Castle.
In the words of one of my more sympathetic correspondents, it has turned out to be an annus horribilis.
In 1997, Princess Diana died in a car crash. It was a low point for the royal family, as the crowds criticised them for staying in Scotland.
Take care of the boys.
That's what we've been doing.
The Queen eventually decided to speak.
I admired and respected her for her energy and commitment to others, and especially for her devotion to her two boys.
The Queen's life has been a continual process of evaluation, re-evaluation, shaping how you keep in touch with a world that's changing very fast. But she was always doing that.
In recent years, the Queen led the monarchy through more turmoil, with the Sussexes leaving and Prince Andrew facing sex abuse allegations. She rarely showed emotion in public. Privately, she was known for her genuine warmth and kindness.
One of my predecessors said, you never come out of your morning session with the Queen feeling worse than when you went in.
She was always worried about you and how you were.
Yeah, must be fighting to do.
Yeah, and how your family were.
You stick all these things in.
We were up shooting one day up in Balmoral, and the weather changed in the afternoon. So I took my raincoat, wrapped it round, I gave him my scarf and my gloves. And as I walked away, I cheekily took my flat shooting hat off and put it on top of a headscarf. 3 weeks later, she called me into her office and she'd had this photograph developed and put in a beautiful frame for me. And she said, I thought you'd like to keep this as a souvenir of that very funny afternoon we had up in the hills of Scotland.
It's one paw. That's it.
She was never happier than when she was with her dogs and watching her horses.
She does relax with racing polk. Yes, definitely.
Has won for Her Majesty the Queen.
When she gets the racing polk, you can see the shoulders drop. You can see her, somebody I know, somebody I've got something in common with. And she does maybe spend a little bit longer with them.
I do remember that suddenly there was a huge fight going on amongst a number of corgis. She waded in and she got bitten in the process, but she sorted it out.
Just sometimes we would see a glimpse of her sense of humour.
Careful what you wish for.
Boom. Oh, really? Please.
Boom.
As she shared the screen with some of Britain's other biggest stars, James Bond at the 2012 Olympics.
The two figures disappeared out of the helicopter. Harry, in complete incredulity, just shouted out, "Go, Granny."
And Paddington Bear for her Platinum Jubilee.
I always keep one for emergencies.
So do I. I keep mine in here.
Oh.
For later.
Thank you. For everything.
That's very kind.
As the Queen grew old,